Take your Bibles, Revelation chapter 22, and we're at the close and with some exciting kind of things that are here, and starting at verse 11 this evening. Father, I come to you before I even open my mouth and ask that you again would just take my thoughts and the things I've studied and all that I want to be able to look at tonight and help us, that we'd be thrilled. And you've said that you'd bless us for reading this word and studying this. And so we need you tonight. And help us in understanding what your Bible says. And also, Lord, help us in our prayers that as we pray together that you'd answer and we'd see some great things because of it. So, Lord, we're excited about the fact that you could come and come soon, and so help us to be out winning people so they would come to Christ and be with us when we all go up. We love you and need you. In Jesus' name, amen. Revelation chapter 22, verse 11, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according to his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city. For without are dogs, and sorcerers, and whoremongers, and murderers, and idolaters, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and offspring of David and the bright and morning star. Hey, great things. He's coming. Behold, I come quickly. Oh, that's a great thing, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And isn't it so wonderful also? Verse 14, blessed are they that do his commandments. You know, and his commandment is that we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. That they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. Wow, what a great thing. One of the things that we went and visited Jeannie's sister and brother-in-law, the fellow that led me to Christ, Pastor Jim Main and Kathy, and we went and visited them. And while Jeannie and Kathy were working on a project for Marcy, Jim and I got to take a look at the video recording of the Sight and Sound Theater's presentation of the creation story, you know, that whole creation story. And in there, of course, you know, the Tree of Life, and then they're blocked from it. The angels, you know, the flaming swords are blocking the way to the Tree of Life, but then we get that access to the Tree of Life. Ah, oh, wow. Mm-hmm. Because of what Jesus Christ has done, that's a good thing. Amen? Mm-hmm. And we may enter in through the gates into the city, and those pearly gates, you know, the size of a pearl that's got a gate in it. I mean, big enough to drive a trailer through. Mm-hmm. That's a big pearl. That's a big clam. Mm-hmm. Amen? I made the pearl. Amen? I don't think I want to step on him when I walk along the ocean. We better pray tonight John doesn't step on one of those while he's at the ocean. Amen? Mm-hmm. But, so, you know, it's exciting to think about the fact that we're going to be able to be there, you know, and all that heavenly things that we've looked at and that New Jerusalem. And, oh, wow, it's going to be great. Amen?
Amen.
Excited. Then verse 14, you know, says not only that about the city, but verse 15 says, for without our dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. Now, I wonder, first of all here, with verse 15, what do you think the word without means? And do you have any scripture to back it up? I'm going to make you teach tonight. Please. I shouldn't say I'll make you. I'm going to ask you to teach tonight. What do you think without means? I mean, does that mean like, you know, just outside that door is going to be all of those kind of people, outside the gate of the city, is that... Is that what that's talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you got to have scripture. Don't just say no. You got to have some scripture. I mean, there is scripture. Amen. I think there is.
1 Corinthians 6:9.
Okay, and it says?
It says, "Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves of mankind."
Amen.
Not with the whole list of 10.
Okay. So they're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. Amen. Good. Mm-hmm. Where else do we have a list similar to that? Close by to where we are.
Revelation 21:8.
Okay, I'm hearing a voice.
Okay, Revelation 21:8.
Okay, Revelation 20 and 21 rather, and verse 8.
Uh-huh.
"But the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable and the murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part just outside the door?"
Uh-uh.
On the new earth that's
uh-huh.
been created? No, where are they going to have their part? In the lake
Amen.
Which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So without doesn't mean just on the other side of the gate. You know, this isn't like, you know, Jerusalem set up and you know, the Gentiles are outside of the gate of Jerusalem here. This is not that. I mean, we've already been told where that list, you know, where they're going to be. In that lake, you know, which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Yeah, the lake of fire. Amen. That's where they're going to be. And chapter 20, verse 15 calls it the lake of fire. So that's where they're going to be. That's with, without. So let me just ask here, what are sorcerers? Comes up in both lists. What are sorcerers?
Magic.
Occultic.
Occultic?
Yeah.
Occultic magic, that kind of thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Jeannie and I went to Bible college with a fellow that could do Christian magic. He did all kinds of Christian magic. He became a missionary to Liberia in West Africa. And he started doing his magic. And guess what they all thought?
Yeah.
He had a devil in him.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
He was doing that by the devil, not by just sleight of hand. And he'd even show them how he did it. They didn't believe him. So they had to stop doing any magic. You know, pull a coin out of the child's ear kind of thing, you know, which we know is so simple a trick, but they didn't think it was, you know, and he could make dots move, and he really wasn't making any dots move, but, you know, it looked like it. He was good. I mean, he was real good at it. And
did he ever find out why they fought that way? I mean, was there...
Just they couldn't explain how he could do those things.
Mm-hmm. So it's out of ignorance that they didn't know, so therefore it must be.
Yeah, yeah. They didn't
know. Interesting thing attributed to a devil.
There are still tribal religions in Liberia, and there's people like General Butt Naked who really brought that to the forefront.
Yeah. So the sorcerers.
Yeah.
All right, sorcerers deal with the occultic, worshiping Satan, that kind of thing, and whoremongers. You know, they're in that list both times. Yeah. People that are only out for sexual things. A whoremonger is a man, you know, looking for women. And, President Bill Clinton was a whoremonger. You know, we'll call him anything else. That's what he is. A whoremonger. Amen?
Couldn't it also be anything that's after trying to satisfy the flesh, like the drug culture?
Mm-hmm. Sure thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'd go for that. And murderers. Mm.
Whosoever hateth a man is.
Yeah. Yeah, Jesus said that, didn't he? Yeah, and murderers. I didn't hear for sure. Did they had a stabbing, where was that? Colorado? Is that where they had a big stab?
Pennsylvania.
Oh, that's right. Pittsburgh, wasn't it?
Yeah, 16-year-old.
16-year-old boy. Yep.
And a knife.
Yep. Yeah, did some die?
Four were critical, but
it could have
four critical.
Said 20 in total.
Yeah.
Before they could stop.
And the assistant mm-hmm. principal tackled him.
And one of the seniors.
No.
Who knows? They might want to ban knives underneath their.
Oh yeah, now we got assault knives. You know, there's, if they're painted black, they're assault knives, you know. And
well, there was that soldier who went crazy in Louisiana last night.
Yeah.
And well, he shot one guy.
Well, we better start protesting all the, don't you think, all the kitchen supply places for selling assault knives.
That's right, yeah.
I think we ought to do that. Picket lines in front of
Well, pressure cookers, too, right?
Pressure cookers, yeah, they sell those there, too.
Well, yep. Socks.
Socks?
Yeah, some boy in a school stuffed a sock in a kid's mouth, held his nose shut, and he died.
Oh, an assault sock.
Assault socks.
Oh, assault sock.
Yeah.
Yep. Back some time ago, they killed an Asian man in Detroit with a baseball bat. Assault bat.
Yeah, how many people get killed in a place like Detroit every year, though?
Yeah.
Yeah, but not with an assault bat. No, I'm telling you. Yeah, murderers. How many people do you have to kill to be called a murderer?
One.
Just one. How many lies do you have to tell to be called a liar?
One.
Just one. I'm glad I'm washed clean.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm glad I've gotten angry enough to want to kill people. And I'm glad I'm washed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. And then it says idolaters. What are they?
People that own boats. People that own boats.
People that own boats.
Right. You can see them on Sunday morning polishing them up and then driving them to the lake.
Oh, yeah. Could be that they love the boat more than they love God. Yeah, yeah. Anything that we love more than God. Yep. Amen.
Well, religious idols also.
Yeah, there's all kinds of religious idols out there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm in the book of Genesis in my daily devotions there where Rachel stole her father's idols, and then of course today where I read the Jacob said, you know, we need to cleanse ourselves and get rid of all the idols, and they buried them somewhere over there, so they got rid of the idols. And then how do you like how it says this, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie? Wow, isn't that something? What is a lie?
Untrue.
Telling the truth.
Not telling the truth?
No, yeah. Not telling
what,
the truth.
What
if
did
you like your plan,
an
you
untruth.
Can keep it.
There you
an
go.
What? No, what I said.
What is it, Brad?
I said if you like your plan, you can keep it, period.
Yeah. Yes, if you like your plan.
You'll save $2,500.
Right, yes, yeah. Everybody's going to save.
Yeah, your cancellation notice.
Yep, everybody's going to save all this money. Yeah, you can keep your doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Isn't that something, all those kinds of things there?
And they wonder why somebody like Putin doesn't believe him when he says, there will be sanctions. You will not get away with this. And he's like, uh-huh.
Right, yeah. Yeah. You can't come in our country anymore.
I'm
really crying. But you know, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 11, it says there, for this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie.
Wow.
Yeah, that's after we're taken out. Because verse 1, now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him. Did we get taken out and they'll believe a lie? Isn't it incredible? I just read this and I was really kind of surprised about it, that the whole global warming, or if you want, the whole climate change thing that's going on, is based on predictions for 100 years from now. So what they're saying is 100 years from now, it's going to be this much warmer if we keep going the way we are. So now we've got to curtail all these things, such as big business, because we don't want big business because it employs people and they make money, and the big business makes a profit and they make money.
And Al Gore lives by the ocean in California in a $9 million mansion, and Mrs. Living off saying,
jets around.
Changes mind, yeah.
But, you know, that's all based on predictions, not on facts, not on things that are actually happening right now.
Yeah.
On predictions. And people believe the lie.
Mm-hmm.
Prediction from a mathematical model.
A mathematical model, yes.
So and that's just so they've extracted or extrapolated a bunch of data that they got and said this is what they're going to get.
Yeah. And one variable can change that outcome.
Phony math.
Yeah.
Well, there's less ice in the Arctic this winter because it all came here.
Yeah. Yeah, Emmanuel wants to say something.
No, different from what we're talking about. Just what I wanted to say, just who a liar is, not with respect to mathematical model.
Right.
As in, a liar is someone who denied Jesus as the Son of God.
Amen.
According to 1 John 5. Uh-huh.
1 John
5:10.
5:10.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Say that believeth on the Son of God.
Amen.
In himself.
Yeah.
That believeth not, God hath made him a liar.
Mm-hmm.
Because
amen.
He believeth not the record that God gave of his Son.
Yes, mm-hmm. Good. Yeah. Exactly, yeah. Yeah. But the wording there that I was trying to get to with my rabbit trail is that, you know, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of people out there that love the lie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they want the lie because they don't want to face the truth. Just like there's a lot of scientists that love the lie of evolution because they don't want the truth. So they love the lie, whether they've, you know, made any contributions to it or not. They just love that lie. They love the lie. And like Emmanuel is saying, they love the lie. They'd rather not trust Jesus Christ as Savior. That's a good verse, Brother Emmanuel. Amen. Thank you for that. And then, of course, and maketh a lie, that's, you know, people that lie, that's thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. And we can lie with the truth and that kind of thing. So, did you notice that I kind of left something out in verse number 15?
Dog? No, we talked.
Mary kind of...
Dog?
Hesitantly. Oh, now Raph's saying it. Yeah. I skipped right over dogs, didn't I? Isn't that something? Now, there was a point in time where I would have said that Dr. Jack Van Ippe and myself were friends. You know, and he's brilliant. I mean, he really is. He's got all the New Testament memorized. And great. I mean, he's called the Walking Bible. He's great, brilliant man. But he came out with a book about, you know, all our pets are going to go to heaven.
Yeah.
Well, you know, if you want the money to keep coming in, you know, you got to reach out to the people that love their pets. So so he did a book on, you know, about all the pets going to heaven. But it says here, you know, for without our dogs. Now, dog and dogs, there's about 40 references in the Bible. I'm not going to take a look at all of those. That's way too many to take a look at. they are not listed, per se, in any of the lists of things that are abominable animals. You know how there's unclean animals that are listed or unclean birds that are listed. They're not in the list, per se, but, you know, they don't chew a cud and they don't have a cloven hoof, so you know, that kind of eliminates them from eating, that kind of thing. But I did think that you ought to take a look at some of the things about dogs. And it's not, you know, not necessarily talking about dogs as pets, but how the Bible uses, you know, this idea of dogs. So we're going to start there in Exodus chapter 11. The first mention is always smart to look at the first time that the word's used, and is used here in Exodus chapter 11, and this is where, you know, God through Moses is telling the people about the death angel is coming through, and he'll of course pass over all of the ones that you know, have the blood and that kind of thing. But if you take a look there at at Exodus 11 and verse 7, it says, "But against any of the children of Israel shall not a dog move his tongue against man or beast." And of course, he had just said the firstborn are all going to be, you know, dead. Verse 6 talks about the great cry throughout all the land of Egypt. And he says there, "Against any of the children of Israel shall not a dog move his tongue against man or beast, that ye may know how that the Lord doth put a difference between the Egyptians and Israel." Now remember, Egypt is always pictured in the Bible as the world, right? So that's always what it is. So we've got the word dog, and then we've got this reference here that says between Egyptians and Israel. And so no dog's going to move his tongue, and the Egyptians are not going to be able to move their tongue, and of course the regular dog isn't either going to be able to do that, but they're not going to move their tongue. They're going to know there's a difference between Egyptians and Israel. And that's what God, God is saying to us there. So this idea of dogs has, yes, the animal as an unclean animal, and we'll see that, but also a reference to some people that are out. There's a difference. And what we saw in Revelation chapter 22 and verse number 15 is that the dogs are without. And there's a difference between Israel and Egypt, and Israel being the chosen ones and Egypt being the ones that are out. That picture that we have. Go with me to Deuteronomy chapter 23 and verse number 18, please. Deuteronomy chapter 23 and verse number 18. And this is interesting here. It says, "Thou shalt not bring the hire of a whore or the price of a dog into the house of the Lord thy God for any vow, for even both of these are abomination unto the Lord thy God."
What was that
reference? It's Deuteronomy chapter 23 and verse number 18. Deuteronomy 23:18. Do you notice how it's used here? We're talking about the hire of a prostitute. You know, if the prostitute were to take her money and bring it to the, what she got for the hire of her body, if she brought that to the temple to give to the Lord, that would, God said that's an abomination. So you've got that and the dogs. You got the two of them, the whore and the dogs. Now, people didn't have like we have today where they're selling dogs, where they raise dogs to sell them and that kind of thing. You know, if somebody had a dog, they used it as maybe to, herd the sheep or something like that. But, you know, like we have with, selling dogs. So the idea here is that a man who sells his body is as a dog. A man who's, because the whore is the woman that does, and the price of a dog. He's thought of as just an animal if
he
does
that. Goes with 17.
What's that?
That goes with 17 also, 23:17.
Right. "There shall be no whore of the daughters of Israel, nor a sodomite of the sons of Israel." Right. Yep. Thank you, Graf. I should have had us read that as well. So we've got the whore and the sodomite, and then we've got here the whore and the dog. And so there's, in the Hebrew mind, there's a correlation there. A man who sells his body like that, is a sodomite, is considered as a dog. Go with me, if you would, to Psalm. No, we better go to 1 Samuel first. I'm sorry. Let's go to 1 Samuel, chapter number 17 and verse 43. 1 Samuel chapter 17 and verse 43. We've got the battle between, Goliath and David. And when David comes out as this youth, ruddy of a fair countenance in In 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 43, and the Philistine said unto David, am I a dog that thou comest to me with staves?
Mm.
And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. You know, so a dog was, to be called a dog was a terrible, terrible thing.
Oh.
You know, it really is. And I know for a fact that Italians to be called a dog, that gets you fighting. That's a bad, bad thing. It really is. And, and the reason I know is that I was working for a crew, landscaping, an Italian crew, and I spoke a little bit of Italian so I could help when the boss was away, to give them some instructions. And because I spoke English quite well, if the homeowner came out and said, well, we want this and this, then I could tell the crew, let's do this kind of thing. Well, it started to rain. I mean, it poured. And so, you know, you can't really be working. And we had one of the fellows, his name was Condolore, which would be Kenneth in English. And Condolore, his job was the trimming. And he did a lot of it by hand shears. So he's out there in the pouring rain, and he's cutting away, cutting away, cutting away. And I went out to him, and I said to him in English, you know, I said to him, Condolore, are you a duck? And he thought I said dog. Mm. Oh boy, he was furious. I mean, he was furious. And he's going on and on in Italian. I mean, he's, wow, and he's got those shears in his hand, you know. And I'm thinking, wow, what in the world did I, you know, I don't know what I said, you know. And all that kind of thing. So, you know, we're waiting and the boss showed up. And as soon as the boss showed up, all the guys, you know, I mean, all in Italian, I mean, they're going on and on. I can hear them. They're using my name. You know, I can hear Bill. Bill. And so I know what they're talking about. And so the boss comes over and he says, why'd you call Kenny a dog? You know, why'd you call Condolore a dog? I said, I didn't call him a dog. I called him a duck because he's working out in the rain, you know. And so then, you know, we had in Italian, duck is pato. And so then, you know, then when I said, no, pato with the rain, you know, and then, oh, then it was funny. Everybody's laughing. You know, he doesn't want to kill me anymore. I'm telling you. So, you know, to be called a dog, bad thing, you know, bad thing. So the Philistines say, what am I, a dog? And there's several references, you know, in the Bible where people talk, you know, about, you know, what am I, a dog? That kind of thing. Another one that we'd look at is in 2 Samuel chapter 9 and verse number 8. 2 Samuel verse number 9, chapter number 9, verse number 8. And of course here, you know, Saul is after David and that kind of thing. And so David says to Saul, in verse 8, and he bowed himself and said, what is thy servant that thou shouldest look upon such a dead dog as I am? You know, he's not only just dog, which is a vile animal in their minds, but a dead dog. You know, what value is a dead dog? You know, you don't want one at all. So of no value is the idea there. Now, if you don't mind, we'll go to Psalm 22, verse 16, and also verse 20. Psalm 22, you should know 22, 23, and 24 are a trilogy of psalms all about Jesus Christ. And of course, Psalm 22 is him as the sacrifice. You know, so a lot of references here to the cross. You know, Psalm 22, verse 1, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Does that sound like the Amen. Cross? Amen? But when you take a look here at Psalm 22 and verse 16, you see this, for dogs have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. That Jesus, they pierced my hands and my feet. And so we get here, dogs and assembly of wicked. Now, you might not like this, but it used to be that Jews thought of all Gentiles as dogs. You know, a vile creature. And I used to know the Jewish word for that, but I don't think I remember it. they used to, I used to know that. Don't get old. Then take a look also at verse 20. It says here, deliver my soul from the sword, my darling from the power of the dog. Yeah. And, you know, so not so good there, do you think? And then Proverbs chapter 26, verse 11. Proverbs chapter 26, verse 11. The Word of God says this, as a dog returneth to his vomit, so a fool returneth to his folly. And remember the word fool in the Bible, Emmanuel. Remember this, anytime you see the word fool, that's someone who's going against God's ways. And that's why, you know, fools end up in the lake of fire, because they're going against God's ways. And that's why it's so bad to call somebody a fool, because you're damning them to hell. Yeah. It's like cursing them. You know, a dog returneth to his vomit, so a fool returneth to his folly. And there's that connection of someone who's going against God's ways is just like a dog. And the dog's vile. He'll go and eat his own vomit. We've had enough dogs. Anybody that's had dogs knows that's true.
Yeah.
Yep, that's true. You know, that's for sure true, that the dog will do that. And so they're not regarded as a clean kind of an animal. I'd ask you to go to Isaiah 66 and verse number 3, if you would. The last chapter of Isaiah, chapter 66 and verse number 3. And we see this. Isaiah 66, 3, he that killeth an ox as if he slew a man, he that sacrificeth a lamb as if he cut off a dog's neck, he that offereth an oblation as if he offered swine's blood, he that burneth incense as if he blessed an idol. Yea, they have chosen their own ways, and their soul delighteth in their abominations. Wow. Now, when they would sacrifice an ox, they would do that by cutting their throat, cutting their neck so they bleed out. Because you're not supposed to have the blood with the meat, you know, that kind of thing. But if you kill an ox as a man, as he slew a man, you know, that's where you just stab them in the heart once. So then all the blood's still inside, or most of the blood is still inside. You see what they're talking about there. Or sacrificeth a lamb as if he cut off a dog's neck. You know, to cut it from the back of the head and just cut off the neck that way. So they just slice the throat to cut the arteries and veins that are there to bleed out that sacrificial animal, right? So that's what it's talking about here. So, you know, do that. I mean, that's how they treated dogs. They just hack off their head, you know, just hack their head off. You know, that's the way to kill a dog, say. Back in those days. Amen? And so, you know, it's an abomination. Can you imagine bringing swine's blood into the temple to offer that to God? How abominable that would be. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the reference there is, it's an abominable thing. Anything to do with the dog that way, abominable. So let's go on to the New Testament, Matthew chapter 7 and verse 6. Matthew chapter 7, verse number 6. In that Sermon on the Mount, you know, we often use this when we're talking about soul winning, but Matthew chapter 7, verse 6, give not that which is holy unto the dogs, neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and rend you. You know, so a lot of times when we're going to pass out tracts, you know, sometimes, you know, we see, now like today I went and got some gas, and I was going to give out the tract, but here's the man, being a whoremonger, trying to get this gal to come on over and talk to him, and I thought, nope, put it back. You know, don't cast your pearls before swine. I mean, you know, I've gone, you know, door knocking, and here's a guy, he's drunk. You know, well, you know, hi, we're from the church and all, but, you know, we're out of here. You know, what do it? But so we say that kind of thing, don't cast your pearls before the swine, but we don't ever talk about, you know, give not that which is holy unto the dogs. Now, of course, you'd think about it. Can you imagine taking that showbread out of the tabernacle or out of the temple and feeding dogs with it? That'd be a terrible thing, wouldn't it? That'd just be a terrible thing. I mean, only the priests, only the holy people were supposed to eat that. And remember that Jesus had to use that about David getting that bread, you know, because they were so needy of food. To give it to dogs? Oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. Well, with that in mind, go over to chapter number 15 and verse 26. Matthew chapter 15, verse number 26. And there we see that, there's this woman that's a Canaanite woman, and begging for her daughter, who's got a devil in her. And at verse 26, but he answered and said, it is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs. Give the bread, here, instead of feeding my child, I feed it to the dog and my child goes hungry. That would be a terrible thing, wouldn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Just a terrible thing to do there. And of course, she comes back there in verse 27, and she said, truth, Lord, yet the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their master's table. And they'll do that quick. Anybody's had a dog in the house, they know. You drop something on the floor, boy, you better get it up quicker. That dog's going to have it, And of course, verse 28, then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith, Amen. Be it unto thee, even as thou wilt. So, it's interesting.
And?
Yeah?
And it's, are you finishing 28? It's just such a great verse.
Yes. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. So she was willing to grovel like a dog. And being a Gentile woman, she was thought of by the Jews as a dog.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, outside of the blessings, outside of the covenants, outside of any of the truths, they were dogs. Yeah, they were without. That's what Scripture says. That's interesting. How many of you have ever heard of a coon dog?
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever heard of a coon dog?
Mm-hmm.
Heard of a coon dog? Why do they call it a coon dog?
They hunt coons.
Because they hunt raccoons.
Yeah.
That's possible. I wonder why they call them raccoons. Coon dog comes from the Greek word that's for dog, which is coon.
Hmm.
Isn't that something? Yeah, that's what the Greeks use for a dog.
Hmm.
And kind of comes over into our language. I don't know if raccoon got named first or they just used that for a dog. And I don't know how that all worked out. But what's that?
They don't have raccoons in Greece.
They don't, okay, if you say so.
No, they only exist in the U.S. and Canada.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, now let's go to Philippians chapter 3 and verse number 2. We're almost done. That one and one more and we're done. Philippians chapter 3, verse number 2. That pretty plain and simple? Beware of dogs.
Mm-hmm.
Beware of evil workers. Beware of the concision.
Mm.
Those that want to split up the church kind of thing. But beware of dogs. Now, is that when you're out door knocking, I mean, there's some truth to that. Brother John and I, we'd look and see, wow, I got a great big leash hooked up to that door. We know they got dogs there, And we knocked on this one door, and because we saw that big leash, we were wondering. And here, like a 10, maybe 11-year-old boy opens the door, and he's got three great big dogs behind him. And I mean, they want us. I mean, they are hungry for some, door knockers. I mean, they're just hungry. And the boy's trying to hold them back and all that kind of thing. And, can we leave you some literature? And he opened the door just that much. Boy, those dogs can't even, I'm telling you. And I'm thinking, I don't know who's going to run faster, Brother John or me. I mean, he's, He's the one that does the marathons. He might, you know, beat me at that, but you know, look.
He just needs to run faster than you.
What's that?
He just needs to run faster than you.
That's all he has to do. That's right. Yeah, just keep ahead of me. And so we slipped that into the young fella, and he took that. And we turned around, and of course he closed the door. We turned around, and a truck pulled in, and it was Dad coming home on lunch. Construction worker, or you know, contract something he did. You know, sat on his truck, and great big burly guy. You know, I'll help you fellas. You know, I said, well, we're, you know, just inviting people to the church over there on, you know, I can't remember the name of the hill road that it was, but on that road, and you know, if it was that your son, yes, well, you know, we gave it to him, and he took it, and then I said to him, you know, I'm sure glad he held those dogs back, and he said, that is a chore. Yeah. So, you know, I mean, but I don't think that's really what he's talking about here. Mm. Huh? Of course, you know where the beware the dog sign came about. I'm telling you the honest truth. This is the honest truth. In Italy, people had the little tiny dogs. Italian greyhound, you know, is a little tiny. They bred for the little tiny, a little tiny dog, right? Mm-hmm. And so they'd have party, and they didn't want people to step on the dog because it'd break its legs. So they put up signs, beware the dog. And that meant, you know, beware, you know, don't step on the dog. Well, some guy had one of these big Pyrenees, you know how big a Pyrenees is?
Yeah.
I mean, they're a huge dog. I mean, it just, you know, just huge, you know. They ate three of me for breakfast, you know, I mean, just huge. And so the guy, for fun, over there, put up beware the dog sign. Mm. And that kind of caught on. If you have a big dog that's mean, beware the dog. And that's where that sign. See, you learned something tonight. Mm-hmm. Amen. Yeah, don't call Italians dog. That's what you also learned. Amen. Mm-hmm. But I think what he's saying here is, you know, there's some people that are without, some people that are, yeah, abominable. You just need to beware of them. Yeah. Need to beware of them. And the last place is 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 22, and it's just a you've seen it already, but just so that you see it, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 22. It says there, but it has happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. Mm. And, you know, it goes back to that idea that, you know, a person that's lost is lost. I mean, they're just going to do the lost things. Shouldn't expect any more from them.
Amen.
They're lost. It's how they act. Right, ma'am? Yeah. But we've escaped, as verse 20 says, the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Yeah, but they're still entangled in it, you know. They'll keep going back to it. So somebody that says they're saved and yet they keep going back to all this sin, you really, really need to question it. Mm. Amen? Need to question it. So, for without are dogs. I'm not sure if, you know, that means there won't be any pets. I mean, God created all the animals.
Amen.
You know, he did create all of them for his glory and beauty. And, you know, it may be that on that new earth, they'll still have all those animals. I don't know. Maybe in heaven there'll be some wonderful, beautiful animals.
Be horses.
There's going to be horses. Yeah, that's true. But, you know, I don't think it's talking here so much about the idea of the animal that goes bark, bark. Mm-hmm. It's got more to do with those that are abominable unto God.
Yeah.
You know, vile people that just keep returning to their sin, they just keep going back again and back again. Yeah. Amen? Mm-hmm. Okay, any questions? Comments?
Well, there in Philippians, that would be, could be false teachers too, right?
Could be false teachers, yeah, sure. Like yep. Yeah. And every time you try to straighten them up, they still go back to their false ways and that kind of thing. Yeah. Yeah. But Jesus is coming. Amen. That's what he says. I'm coming. And that's an exciting thing. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right. Time to get out our prayer sheets and get some requests.